This is Red Ice Creations Radio. My name is Henrik, and I want to thank you for listening to our program and paying attention to the kind of topics that we are focusing on in these interesting times, shall we say, as we break some new ground and discover fascinating things about what is going on this planet. Our website is redicecreations.com. We are growing every day, and I want to thank everyone for your kind emails and the positive feedback we're getting. We read all our email, and we do our best to reply to as much of it as we can. On our website, you can follow along in our frequently updated news, listen to our radio program, watch our webcasts that we just started, by the way, really groundbreaking stuff, and see some of our video interviews, our short films, or listen to some of our extended radio programs that we have available for you on our website. And today we have David Livingstone with us. He is the author of Terrorism and the Illuminati, a 3,000-year history, and also The Dying God, the Hidden History of Western Civilization. And David have two different websites that you can take a look at that are accompanying these books. The website is thedyinggod.com, and the other one you can take a look at is terrorism-illuminati.com. And there's a lot of information up there for you on those websites, so you can further explore some of the areas that David touches upon. And I don't know personally that much about David. I've read a few of his articles, and I think he offers a really interesting perspective, and I want to kind of explore a bit some of these his areas here today and talk more about where he's coming from, so to speak. So I'm very grateful to have you on the line here today, David. Thank you very much for coming on.
And thanks for inviting me.
I mean, tell us a little bit about yourself, some of the background. I want to kind of hear a little bit about how you kind of first got involved in some of the, in researching some of these areas, David.
I think the easiest way to explain it is that, I guess it was about 20 years ago exactly that I was in a university program called Liberal Arts College, and I've since learned that this was an attempt to preach the Hegelian version of history, which is a novel approach and one that's been generally abandoned in education. And so we focused on a history text by the History of Western Civilization by William H. McNeill, who's a professor at the University of Chicago. His mentor was, I can't remember his mentor's name, but his mentor was the one who was responsible for inviting Leo Strauss to the University of Chicago. Hmm. So this book is, you know, probably the clearest outline of the propaganda version of history that you could come across. And this was the kind of nonsense that they were trying to impose upon me. A funny experience I had, too, is that at the time, even though I didn't understand, I wasn't educated enough to understand what was happening, what the effort was, but I was challenging my professor, and she said to me, you know, because I said, you know, the problem is I don't always agree with you. She says, well, you know, we want to see that you've learned something, and this is a great lesson, you know, this is obviously that I wasn't allowed to challenge this view. I was there to accept it.
Yes.
And the basic where my research started was this might seem like a remote point, but it's really the underlying issue that helped me discover everything that I've discovered and everything that I reveal in my two books, and really understanding the whole mystery of what we're being subjected to. And there was a reference to the sudden emergence of the Indo-Europeans from the Caucasus Mountains between a period of approximately 2,500 BC. Mm. So when I read this, it sounded really odd. It didn't make any sense. You know, you look at any other civilization, they emerge slowly over time by people settling down in certain areas like Mesopotamia or Egypt, and they turn to agriculture, which allows them to develop civilizations. Whereas the Indo-Europeans do the opposite. And they begin violently. So they emerge out of the Caucasus, and, you know, which is nonsensical. You know, it's like expecting people to just suddenly emerge from the Alps. You know, I mean, where right. how do people come out of mountains and then supposedly conquer and subjugate the advanced civilizations of the time?
Right.
So it didn't make any sense. It was weird. It sounded mythical. So I just started researching it, and little by little, I eventually discovered what was this notion of these Indo-Europeans was actually a euphemism for the Aryan race. And I eventually discovered that the idea of an Aryan race was a Masonic idea or an occult idea. So then I went on to find out, well, what is this occult religion? How does it have so much impact on history? Mm. And that's when it gets convoluted, because the occult versions of history are very elaborate. So if you read, there's plenty of material as well. I mean, there's lots of books where you can discover the occult versions of history, and they kind of closely mirror mainstream versions of history. But of course, the ideas that are discussed in the occult are never referred to in mainstream versions of history. So how do you study it, right?
Right.
How do you just study the veracity of these claims? You know, when they say that Pythagoras was a godfather of the occult tradition, and he preached so and so, such and such and such and such. How do you check that? And so it becomes very interesting, because you get into this kind of no man's land of history, of this kind of bridge between mainstream and occult mythology. But it's where the answers are, because the version of history that we're being taught is an occult, it's a whitewashed version of occult history. So it's the occult history without actually ever referring to the occult. Do you know what I mean?
Sure.
And this is the point, is that this is the modern propaganda. Basically, we can go back to approximately 250 years since this version of history is being imposed, basically since the Enlightenment, but more particularly since Hegel. It's a completely novel way of interpreting history, a complete rewrite of history, but it's been so entrenched that today there's no memory of any other perception of history.
Right.
What they are trying to teach us is history as really their secret plan, but their secret and the progress of their secret plan, and teaching it to us as if it's just the natural and spontaneous intellectual evolution of humanity.
Right. So I just want to ask you. So I mean, when you were taking this this course, this class you were talking about, did you just feel that something was wrong in the way that they explained history in that regard, or did you at that point already had some kind of alternate version that you relied on to get your information, so to speak?
No, I didn't have an alternate version yet. I just had a sneaking, wasn't even a sneaking suspicion. It was just a very basic intuition.
Right.
This bogus, or fishy at least. So I started to dig. And it's only recently that I've discovered, and now I'm very suspicious about this place, because no, really, I mean, they deliberately used the Owl of Minerva as the mascot of this place. And if anybody wants to look it up, it's the Liberal Arts College of Concordia University. The Owl of Minerva, of course, is a very important symbol, and a very important occult symbol, and it was obliquely referred to by Hegel, and that's the reason why they use the mascot by that school, because it was referred to by Hegel, and it has a long history, the owl symbolism, but that made it very very fishy indeed.
Okay.
Oh yeah, the point I wanted to make is that is that when the Illuminati was originally founded, one of the first grades of the Illuminati were was the Minerval grades, or the grades of Minerva, which were considered for, I believe they were set up for young people to kind of begin their entry into Illuminati indoctrination.
Hmm.
So interesting that they would use the, you know, to basically create a Minerval college.
Yes, yes. So, I mean, I want to also kind of back out a little bit and again talk about this big perspective and if you will kind of paint a picture for us. You've begun doing so already, obviously, but more of just of who is in control of the world today. I mean, we can approach this from different areas. We can talk about some of the different groups that you've been primarily studying or some of the different agendas that are out there. But where do you think is a good place to begin? Let's say you're talking to a novice in this subject, so to speak. I mean, for instance, you put the title of Illuminati on your book, of course. And if we begin there, or specifically referring to like the Order of Perfect Abilists that Weishaupt set up in Bavaria, or are using this term, as many researchers do now, as a broad term to kind of explain a larger group or an agenda?
Yeah. I use it as a broad term because, like as I said, as I started to discover this occult version of history, I sought out to find out its origin. And I wanted to be very accurate in what I wanted to discover it for, you know, its definite origins. And what of course everybody knows that the occult is based on Kabbalah. But Kabbalists claim that it originates originally from Babylon, or they say it originates from Moses or the fallen angels before the flood, so on and so forth. So those are various claims about the antiquity of the Kabbalah.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've determined is that it emerged in the 6th century BC. So when I say Illuminati, I'm talking about a secret occult doctrine which has been preserved and pushed forward, or which accompanies an agenda that's been pushed forward since the 6th century BC. Mm-hmm. So, of course, Illuminati was created in the 18th century, so it has to be used in a broader sense to refer to this group or secret organization, which has been around for a very long time.
Yes. The Kabbalists, let's begin there. What do you think, where do you think that this, originates from? You're mentioning Babylon and way back. Are we talking about the Hebrews or a Zionist faction here? What do you think, David?
Yeah. And the interesting thing is, what happens is in the 6th century BC, when the Jews were taken into Babylon, there's argument about how many, but supposedly nearly the entire population, or at least the best and the brightest of the population, were taken to Babylon in captivity. And what happened is that this was a huge catastrophe for the Jewish people, because they had already been placed in the Promised Land according to their own scriptures. So their settlement in the Promised Land was understood as a binding agreement between themselves and God. So when they became severed from the land of Zion, essentially, it forced them to reinterpret the meaning of their relationship with God.